The era of the 1890s was known as the Progressive Era because of rapid economic and social growth. In 1891, Benjamin Harris is the President of the United States. James Stephen Hogg is the first native-born Texan to become our governor. The New York Music Hall, later to be known as Carnegie Hall, opened with Tchaikovsky as the guest conductor. And women's fashions had lost the bustle, but not the corset. Published popular music of the time is listed here. And our personal favorite, "You'll Miss Lots of Fun When You're Married" by John Philip Sousa.
By your own little wife, when you finished your diurnal toil, of course you must give up your bachelor ways and the smile that you always have carried, and think with remorse on your old reckless ways. Nevertheless, you'll miss lots of fun when you're married.
The Daughters of the Republic of Texas is a lineal organization whose mission is to educate, research, preserve, and protect the history of the Republic of Texas for all future generations. We must always remember the many sacrifices made to protect us from tyranny, injustice, and preserve our freedom. During the summer of 1891, in her father's law library in Galveston, now known as the Cradle, Miss Betty Ballinger and her cousin, Miss Haley Bryan, conceived the idea of perpetuating forever the memory of the Texas pioneer families and soldiers of the Republic of Texas by forming an association of their descendants. The two cousins then traveled to Houston, where they shared their thoughts with 14 other ladies at the home of Mrs. Andrew Briscoe on the afternoon of November 6, 1891. At that meeting, they formed the organization that is known today as the Daughters of the Republic of Texas. Join us now as we recite a bit of history based on applications of some of our earliest members.
I, Hallie Ballinger Bryan, do hereby apply for membership in this society by lineal descent of Moses Austin. I was born in Galveston, the 10th of January, 1868. I am the co-founder of the Daughters of the Republic of Texas and an honorary life president. It is to be the mission of this society to encourage historical research, to promote the celebration of Texas's Independence Day, March 2nd, and to honor the memory of the people who fought to establish the Republic. I am the great-granddaughter of Moses Austin, who was born in Durham, Connecticut on the 4th day of October, 1761, and his wife Mary. He was the one who originated the colonization of Texas. While living in Virginia, Moses formed the plan of colonizing Texas. He then visited San Antonio, the capital of the province of Salamanca, Spain, now Texas. He was coldly received by those in power and ordered to leave the province. He sought help from his former colleague, Baron de Bastrop. Baron de Bastrop was able to plead with then-provincial Governor Martinez, who allowed Moses to send a petition to the commander in Monterey. His petition requested that he be allowed to introduce 300 families into Texas. The old 300. After a return journey of great hardship from Texas, Moses reached his former home in Virginia in an enfeebled condition. In the spring of 1821, he commenced to move to Texas, but he never recovered from his illness. A cold settled in his lungs, and he died June 10, 1821. But a few days before his death, he received news of the success of his application. He left the work of colonizing Texas to his son, Stephen F. Austin, who was in New Orleans at the time. History reflects how well my Uncle Stephen did. Hallie Ballinger Bryan, October 9, 1892.
I, Mrs. Mary Jane Briscoe, hereby apply for membership in this society by right of my husband, Judge Andrew Briscoe, who was born in Adams County, Mississippi, on the 25th day of November, 1810. He lived in Anahuac, Houston, and Harrisburg, and served the cause of Texas independence. I am the daughter of John R. Harris, one of Austin's first 300 settlers, and Jane Birdsall. My father is credited as being one of the founders of Harrisburg. I currently reside at 620 Crawford Street in Houston, Harris County. I am the treasurer of my reading club. My husband came to Texas in the winter of 1832. In 1834, he sold goods in his store in Anahuac on Galveston Bay, near the mouth of the Trinity River. In June of 1835, he traveled with my brother, David Harris, and William Smith to Harrisburg to exchange goods. The Mexican captain there arrested my husband, my brother, and shot down William Smith. The bullet penetrated him on the right side. They were told they were infringing on the custom house laws by moving goods from Anahuac to Harrisburg. They were put in prison. There was no such rule, and an innocent man was shot down. As time went on, they could not make a case against my brother, so he was released. My husband remained in prison. My brother reported the incident to the authorities, and William Travis and Patrick Jack lost no time in going to rescue my husband. William Travis and his companions disarmed the Mexican captain and his men and marched them to San Antonio, where they were kept for several days. This angered the Mexican government. A decree was issued to imprison Lorenzo de Zavala, William Travis, and others, and to establish Mexican military garrisons in all towns and disarm all inhabitants. Upon this arbitrary measure, my husband and my brother wrote and published circulars that they printed by hand so that they could be easily read by all. My husband organized the Liberty Volunteers, and they marched to San Antonio, where they engaged the Mexicans in the Battle of Mission Concepcion in 1835. My husband was one of the 300 volunteers who followed old Ben Milam to the attack and capture of San Antonio de Bayer in 1835. My husband said it was the hardest fighting that the Army ever had. My husband was elected to the convention in Washington on the Brazos in 1836, where he wrote his name next to his colleague, Lorenzo de Zavala, to the Texas Declaration of Independence. Sam Houston later appointed him to Chief Justice of Harrisburg. He retired to New Orleans in 1849, where he died. He is buried in the Briscoe Cemetery in Claiborne, Mississippi. Mary Jane Harris Briscoe. Application dated about 1893.
I, Louise Cannon Ellsbury, do hereby apply for membership in this society by right of lineal descent in the following line of my grandfather, Hanson Ellsbury, who was born in Virginia in 1801 and joined Stephen F. Austin's colony in 1824. I was born in 1870 in Galveston. My grandfather served as a quartermaster. He was an attorney and known as an excellent rifleman. Grandfather was very much opposed to merging the nationality of the Republic with the powerful neighbor, the United States. This no doubt brought him consternation in the community, which was divided on the subject. He would not allow light in his residence, which made it dark and dreary in the midst of the thousands of lighted candles which gleamed from the window panes along the streets. I had four great uncles in military service of the Republic. Dr. Horace Alsbury was taken prisoner in San Antonio when the place was captured, and his wife, Jane Navarro Alsbury, was in the Alamo the day before the battle. She was escorted out under flag of truce by order of Santa Anna at the request of her father, Don Juan Navarro. William Wirt Alsbury was part of the ill-fated Santa Fe expedition led by Don Jose Antonio Navarro that left Austin in the summer of 1841 in hopes of annexing part of New Mexico to the Republic. It was a difficult journey. Water was scarce and the group got lost on the high plains. It took 3 months to get to New Mexico, only to be met by 1,500 Mexican soldiers who took them captive. The prisoners were marched to Mexico City, where they were imprisoned. After vigorous diplomatic efforts by the United States, Mexico finally agreed to release the Texans and sent them home. My uncle experienced all the sufferings of the journey and capture. While they were suffering for food, my uncle killed a buzzard and surreptitiously placed it in the fire to roast when he was called away. When he returned, he discovered that his comrades stole his prize and he never got a piece of the unsavory bird. Louise Cannon Alsbury.
In this year of 1919, I, Emma Brill McCaughey, do hereby apply for membership in this society by right of lineal descent from my father, Solomon W. Brill, who was born in New York on the 23rd day of April, 1803, and lived in Seguin, Texas. He served the cause of Texas independence. I was born in Seguin. My father, Solomon Brill, came to Texas in the year 1836. Solomon Brill had attended medical school in New York. At the time of the yellow fever epidemic in the early 1830s, he volunteered to come to New Orleans. It was there that he not only gave his service as a physician, but became an expert in the making of caskets. While in New Orleans, he enlisted with a company of men to come to Texas and help her fight for independence. He was a veteran of the Battle of San Jacinto. He came to Seguin soon after the Battle of San Jacinto and was a house guest of Juan N. Seguin. It is likely that his skill as a casket maker caused him to be selected on February 25, 1837 by Juan Seguin to go to the Alamo and help gather and bury the remains of those killed there. Several men from the town, then called Walnut Springs, were commissioned to perform this last service for the martyrs of the Alamo. My father, with his helpers, constructed a walnut casket, and in it they placed the five skulls and other bones, which they believed to be those of leaders, because of metal insignia adjacent to these bones. It was a gruesome task, as almost a year had passed since they had died and gone unburied. Before he died, Brill told his son that the casket was buried 20 paces from the southeast corner of the Alamo. My father served in the Battle of Salado in 1842. He was a charter member of the Texas Veterans Association. Solomon Brill died in 1882 and is buried in Brill Cemetery in Seguin.